Thank you. Thank you. and announce us on the second half and just walk on. That's the way it is. I like a good announcement, it just prepares me.
Yeah.
You know, I just gotta walk on, sit down, wait for everyone to stop talking. I look like an idiot. No. Well, maybe I do look like an idiot, I don't know. It doesn't matter. I'm just dressed like this because I have an Australian accent, so I have to dress like this. It's the appearances, that's what you have to do. You guys don't want an Australian accent when it comes to wood. It's not a good start when you do that. People want an Arab accent, they want pain, exile, tears. They want the narrative. The Orientalist narrative. I'm breaking it. I'm breaking the narrative. This is what I'm trying to do now. No more narrative. No, don't do it. Wait, wait, wait. I'll have to draw the line somewhere. So let's play some music. So we'd start off with a piece called Reason and Passion. James and I, I recorded an album in 2009 called The Prophet, music inspired by the poetry of Khalil Gibran, the great Arabic poet. He wrote The Prophet in 1923, and he says, "Reason and passion are the rudder and sails of your seafaring soul."
Thank you.
much. Now I'd like to bring out Dimitri Goros and clarinet, Matt McMahon on camera. Quartet. Carl went home. He had enough. It's enough. It's not happening. Carl gets paid per note. What's that, mate?
Oh, I'm just going to ask for Carl's bass.
That's alright. I like audience interaction, but no. Not this time. Can you throw me off? Keep the audience yelling out to a minimum, please. It's not an RSL. Dare you? No.
I do.
No. Okay. You guys get a bit rowdy, but you know, it's alright. Okay, we do it to ourselves. It comes with the territory. We're not all precious. It's not sacred. We'd like it to be sacred, but you know, it's the best we can do. Camelot, Marrickville. Thursday night. What is it? Is it Thursday tonight?
Yeah.
Thursday. No, we love playing here because we've got, you know, it's good. It's nice and relaxed. Everyone's up close. It's, you know, it's good. Thanks for coming, by the way. We really appreciate it. It's always good. No. What are you applauding yourselves? Yourself, what's wrong? Okay, so I'm just in one of these moods where I'm just going, the first set was really exhausting, so I'm just, you know, I'm buying time. Because we don't have enough repertoire. We have plenty of repertoire. So we thought we'd play the quartet, because as I said earlier, we're celebrating 10 years of Angel, and so we thought we'd play one of the pieces off the album. This was a piece called, Angel was about... It was about angels, about a Mary Baker Eddy quote actually really inspired me once upon a time. And she says, when angels visit us, we do not hear the rustle of the wings, nor feel the feathery touch of the breast of a dove, but we know their presence by the love they create in our hearts. It was kind of that kind of beautiful vibe. It was quite ethereal back then, of 10 years ago. And this one's a less ethereal piece. This is kind of Fall. It was called Fall, and it was one of the faster pieces on the album. So here's a piece called Fall.
Thank you.
Cal Duncliffe on bass. We are tuning at the moment, just in case you're unaware that we are tuning. This is what our band sounds like when it tunes up. Because, you know, you never know these days. You just never know. It could be a piece. You know, you go to this classical music concert, contemporary, they say. Contemporary classical music concert, guess what? Instrumentalist gets on stage, starts tuning a little bit, contemporary piece. And then sometimes they even have like samples. He sampled someone tuning and he plays it in the background and then they play over the top. Contemporary music, contemporary classical music, sometimes it's a little bit difficult for me, I don't tell you. I'm a bit of conservative when it comes to that. You know, because, you know, you pay a bit of money to go see a classical music concert and then somebody pulls out, you know, something like a vibraphone and sponge or something. And you go, why are you doing that for? Not on. That's not on. Vibraphone and sponge. I did mention this one, but James and I were at a concert and they had a piece for bass drum and sponge. One, I don't even like a piece for bass drum, let alone bass drum and sponge. It's like a cleaning sponge. And that's fine. If you want to do that, that's fine. If you want to do that for 15 minutes, that's okay. Split it up into three movements, sure. You can do that. But don't read a score. It looks silly. They're just turning pages every couple of bars. They're turning pages, they're scrubbing. But what was it going to do? Oh yeah, bar 48 didn't scrub hard enough. The composer's upset. They didn't really scrub hard enough there, mate. What's going on? You ruined the piece. Anyway, I don't know. I don't get it. And then what I actually hate about that exercise is that the composer gets up at the end and takes a bow. What's up with that? You sit down. Wouldn't be proud of that. That's your sponge. Yeah, that's what happens, that's contemporary music. So, as I said, we do have a new album out. It's wood, bass drum and sponge collaboration that we're working on at the moment. It's wild. It's really turned the wood on its head. The wood's never been cleaner. Anyway, let's play some more music. This next piece is one of our more popular tunes. People seem to like it. This one's a piece called Permission to Evaporate. Look, she's having a heart attack. Yeah. Look at now, what's going on? That's what happens, even the title. You're losing people in the audience. It's all those stairs. Once you get up, you get excited for the music, you're done. You get six hospitalized a night. Camelot lounge. Anyway, let's play Permission to Evaporate. And it's really good. Seeing a lot of lights, different lights this one. This is James and I are performing it currently with the Australian Chamber Orchestra in a string arrangement. We all played it last year with the BBC Symphony in Dubai. So yeah, it's seen a lot of different things. And this time it's with clarinet. This is, I think, the first time we're playing with clarinet. So here is a piece called Permission to Evaporate. Thank you. Everyone have a good time?
Yeah!
Thanks for coming. We love playing here. It's really good, and hopefully you keep on coming back. Got another show before I head back to London on the 26th of... just James and I. But we'll do just the brothers, because, you know, James is always excited on stage. I thought, why not bring that excitement and isolate it for one night?
Center.
So James is meditation. That's what he meditates. You don't know how long he sat on top of. So he's got a very good vocabulary, and he taught himself, and we love it. And you know, he's got some great technical things, which other places don't have. The big brother's here, actually, sitting over there. He's security. Here, Sam, now take a bow, John. Yeah, get up, show him. He's the guy with the afro. He's the only Tawadros with an afro. That's it. He looks surprisingly like the milkman for some reason. The milkman had an afro too, it's just a bit weird. He never drank milk either. I don't know why. He didn't have a milkman. I don't even know what I'm talking about. I'm just so tired. I don't know if you noticed, but I'm sponsored by Reclaim Australia. They put me in this outfit. I'm trying to make me look great again. People don't know, Pauline Hanson loves the oud. She loves it. A lot of people don't know, there's all these people, a lot, you guys don't know, we played for, people love music and stuff and culture. You know, it's like, you know, all those people that, you know, did the riots and stuff, all those Aussie blokes, I'm sure after the riots they went and had a falafel roll. You know, let's go get the Arab, mate, what do you want to eat? Oh, falafel roll would be great. Mohammed's shop open? Yeah, let's go there. Got a good snack pack. You know, I'm just saying, I love this country, that's what I love about it, so I love coming back. Go to London, see how everything works, and then come back here, it's like, hey, yeah, mate, I watched the State of Origin last week. Honestly, I haven't watched, like, rugby league for a while. That is unbelievable. The commentary. Yeah, we got Benji on the side. Yeah, mate, they couldn't tackle him, so he had spiders on him. Yeah, mate, he did it. Honestly, I was watching this, I had to store it in my brain because I thought this is incredible. And, yeah, mate, he did a chip and chase, and see ya, wouldn't want to be ya. Alright, no worries. Now, let's play some wood for yous. See, James and I are actually working on an album of Australia. We've got it all down pat. We've got, working class man. Check this out. He used to teach me all these raga stuff. Indian music goes for 3 hours. None of that, John. Playing triple Aussie world music right here. We're doing none of that 3 hour raga stuff, mate. Yeah. No, I'm kidding. John Napier, great guy, great lecturer, great cellist. Check him out. Gave me second class honours. So, just to say that. You know what? I mentioned that once. He was at a festival. I mentioned that. So I said, John Napier's in the audience because now he's a groupie. I said, no, John Napier's in the audience, and this woman went up, and I said, yeah, he gave me second class honors, and this woman went up to me, shame on you.
Inadequate knowledge and analysis of household cleaning implements, I told you.
That was it. Then it right at least. Alright, let's play some more music, because I get sidetracked, because you know, you're all my friends, it's like a family barbecue here, I love it. Let's do it. So let's play a piece called Eye of the Beholder. This piece I wrote when we were going to play with the Australian Chamber Orchestra, and we needed pieces that had elements of Baroque music, and we did some Four Seasons and Vivaldi, and so I composed the piece, which kind of sounded a bit Baroque and Middle Eastern. So here's a piece called Eye of the Beholder. Thank you. tuning. So the other thing is, a lot of people don't know that you can, you know, that Arabic musicians have to tune, because you know sometimes people get sucked into the narrative, you see, and you know, sometimes, you know, a Western audience may hear something and go, "Hey Maureen, that sounds a bit out of tune." But they won't say that. They'll say, "That's part of the culture, isn't it?" I think that's what the music, that's how they play their music. I can't say anything. What I'm going to say to you, don't doubt yourself. Okay? Arab musicians can actually play out of tune. We actually have things called quarter tones, that's true. I mean, do you guys want an education lesson?
Yeah.
A quick one for education. This is wood for Aussies now. Now, if you play first three notes of major, so Arabic music is made up of modes called makams. And if you play, let's say the first three, there's different scales, different names. So if you play the first three notes of the major scale, so C, D, E, you can play the first three notes of the minor scale. Now there's an Arabic scale called Rust, and you can fit an interval in between that third note. So here's major, here's minor, and here's Rust, the quarter tone in between. See that? So in the West that can be considered out of tune, but in Middle Eastern music there's actually scales and things that they, you know, if I play Waltzing Matilda with it. It sounds out of tune to Western ears, but it is an Arabic. By the way, the musician, when they play, are not supposed to yell out Allah to each other. It's usually the Arabic audience yell that back if the phrase is good. But I can't trust you guys. So I have to do my own. Person on the other side. I've got to tell you, James actually plans this. So I just don't, because James is a whole lot of laughs. He writes a lot of my jokes. He's the writer. No, he said some really good things. Like the other day, what did he say? When I said, James, we should play Working Class Man, he said we should call it Working Class Imam. That's one of James' devices. By the way, if there's any Muslims in the audience, happy Eid. You know, it's Eid now, you know. Happy Ramadan.
2 hours.
What, in 2 hours? Well, fine, I'll retract that. Not happy Eid for you. Away in 2 hours then. Wish you then.
Eid Mubarak.
Eid Mubarak, that's what they say. Eid Sheeran, that's what they say. Great, Arabic artist, Eid Sheeran. Sorry, I was saving that one all day. That's the reason I wished happy Ramadan.
Finally!
We're actually Coptic, so we're the Coptic Egyptians are kind of minority in Egypt. They're a Christian minority, and Tawadros is they have a pope, and the pope's name is actually Pope Tawadros II. And I used to be the more famous Tawadros before he came along. So he's ruined my Google searches now. I try and search my reviews, and I'm like, what's going on? And the other day, I'm serious, this is no lie. I searched because somebody wanted the cover of my album, The New York Sessions. I searched New York Sessions, put images, and he came up. And I'm like, why's the Pope coming up for New York Sessions? I don't know, but anyway, after he became Pope, my album skyrocketed. I mean, love what the Pope's doing with the wood. The direction's incredible. He's doing some holy playing there. No, but anyway, this is a true story. It happened on the weekend. So last week, I played in Woodend. It was a Woodend Winter Arts Festival, and I went and played there, and I went there. Well, that's what you do when you go and play somewhere, you go there first. And I went there, I know sometimes I do it via hologram now, I mean, technology. Anyway, I went there, and somebody said, you know what, there's a Coptic monastery here in Woodend. I'm like, what? Coptic monastery? I mean, this is cool. So I rang them up, I thought, and it turned out to be a nunnery, so it was two nuns there, this like big estate. And so I rang them up and said, can I visit, you know, the pilgrimage or something? And they said, yeah, went over, met them, there's two lovely nuns, and they showed me the property, it was great, they made me some, you know, had some sweets and tea and stuff, and I said, I'm playing tonight, and, you know, the concert's in a church, it was a classical music festival, I said, the concert's in a church, why don't you guys come to the concert? They said, I'm not allowed to leave here, I'm not allowed. I said, oh, there's surely somebody we can call. They said, no, look, we'd love to come. I said, yeah, but, you know, isn't there any rule where you have to kind of support Copts? You know, so I'm the only Copt in the town. You know, there's got to be, you know, things. You know, there's stories throughout history where things have happened, you know, the saint stories, that they had to do things that they weren't allowed to do. They had to do them, you know. And I was digging deep, because, you know, when you're a cult, you're very, you know, you're brought up very religiously, and they have these kind of saint movies. So these movies that we watch about saints. So I remember I was digging deep from my movie days. What happened there? And I remember, yeah. What was that Roman emperor? What did he do? And then, yeah. So anyway. So I started. No, there was. I actually gave him an example. There was one saint who was fasting, and in Egypt, the cops, they fast vegan. By the way, I'm giving you so much. This is an education thing now. It's a lecture. Turn into a lecture. I'll pull out PowerPoint presentation. Anyway. So they fast vegan, and this saint. You know, they had to cut a deal. You know, there was something that happened, and there was like some, you know, bad emperor and stuff. And the emperor went, "All right, you got to eat a goose. If you eat a goose, I'll let it happen." He had to eat a goose. That's what I'm saying. That was against the rules. He was fasting, but he ate a goose. He probably had a good time. It was delicious. I mean, if you're fasting, you get permission to eat a goose. That's awesome. But anyway, so I gave that example as a joke, and I said, "No, we can't leave." I said, "We'll ring a priest or something." They said, "All right, we'll ring this priest." I rang the priest. No go. And I'm like, I'm a very persistent human being. I said, no, this can't be. So I said, they said, well, you could try the bishop. I said, well, give me the bishop's, can I have his number? I've never spoken to the bishop before. I said, can I have his number? I thought, you know, my name's Tawadros. You know, he's probably heard me from searching for the Pope on Google. He probably knows me from there. True story. That's what happened when I actually met the Pope. I met Pope Tawadros, and he knew about me, and it was probably because we're the only two on Wikipedia. Yeah, true story. Anyway, that's why I held the meeting. I said, we need to change this. Started up my Google searches. Anyway, it was like, they called it like the Kim Trump summit. That's how it was. Two Tawadros meet, we shook hands. It was incredible. You guys should check this online. Incredible. There was a countdown to it. Tawadros meets Tawadros. Incredible. The Wikipedia summit. Something like that. Anyway, you guys don't know it. Man, you guys should check this stuff on the internet. Anyway, so I messaged the bishop. Bishop Suriel, and I said, Your Holiness, it's Joseph Tawadros, the wood player, hoping that he might have heard of me. I said, Joseph Tawadros, the wood player here, I'm in Wood End performing, and I realised there's a monastery, and I went and I met the nuns, and they're so lovely, and would it be, I know I'm like the only Copt here, and it'd be great to have some Coptic support, it'd be great for them to meet the local community, because none of them met them, you know, they know it exists, and you know, all that sort of stuff. You know, I called him Your Holiness, but I know you're supposed to call him Your Grace. Holiness is a big one, so I thought borrowing up with the Holiness. Because I used Your Holiness a lot, but that's His Grace. Anyway, he replied, he said, Hi Joseph, I have several of your albums on iTunes. That was my opening sentence. I'm not lying. I wish I had a PowerPoint presentation showing this SMS. I have several of your albums on iTunes, and had I known earlier, I personally would have come to the concert. It is against the rules for them to attend. However, because the concert's in a church, I'll make an exception. You know, they walked in, I told the story on stage, there was applause, it was great. It was a really beautiful, I felt really great.
Yeah.
I thought, man, I've got influence here. Coffee church. That's what happens. But it is, yeah, we're a good bunch of peeps. John's very active in the Coptic church, my brother, with the afro. The afro representative. John actually plays bass. We tried to get him in the trio, but he failed the audition. Tried to make a family band. My dreams were shattered. I bought the bus and everything. Let's play some more music. Let's play Guardian. This is one off the Angel album, but we've added bass to it. So this is a piece called Guardian. So I'll play Guardian Angel. Oh, I'm feeling a bit holy. This is good. Let's go with the Guardian.
Thank you.
every concert we like to play a piece for our parents. Our mother passed away in 2012, actually 6 years to the day. So hence the energy for us is a little bit, yeah, it's a little bit mixed. It's weird that after 6 years you still kind of feel it on the day. There's something in this fear that just kind of affects you. So 6 years to the day, our mother passed away and our father passed away in 2013, a year later. And so we like to play a piece for them in every concert, just to remember them and remember their, you know, their encouragement and enthusiasm and just having parents around and the love that they give you and set you up for the rest of your life. And at the same time, Matt had lost his brother and his parents, so it's quite a tough time for all of us. So. Music is a type of healer, and I'm glad that we have that, and it's always nice to just spare a thought and think of the people that we've loved and lost, and always open it up to the audience to think of the people that share our pain and have gone through similar things, and it's that type of connection with the audience. I know there's one particular person as well in the audience that I know the music means a lot to him, and he writes me, and it's really quite beautiful. And it's really such a—I can't really describe the feeling when somebody else, or that I could try to provide some sort of healing, and that we kind of understand these kind of emotions that are very confusing. And so that's what is beautiful about music—connecting with strangers and having the same emotions. And so that's what we'd like to do with this piece, is to open it up. And just think of people that we've loved and lost, and also the people that are less fortunate than us are doing it tough around the world. There's so many people that are not, they're not even dead. They're really doing it tough, and every day is a struggle for life. So there's people that are way less fortunate that we should be thinking of too, and sending them beautiful energy. So this is a piece called Rose, which I wrote for my mother a while back, and we haven't performed it in a very long time. It's probably the first time we're going to all perform together. It's a piece called Rose, which I wrote for you, and hopefully it means as much to you as it does to us. So this is Rose. Thank you. much. So that was Rose. Unfortunately, we've come to the last piece. Thank you very, very much for having
me.
Don't worry, the last piece is a 3-hour Indian raga. I was taught by John, and guess what? I'm going to play it in a second class style, John.
Why so short?
Yeah, this is the express version, only 3 hours. I was once watching an Indian musician play. He went, you know, he was doing the narrative. I'm a narrative identifier. When I go to concerts, okay, this guy's putting on a bit of spin. I know this one. And he went, I won't do an Indian accent just in case I get in trouble, but he said, if you listen closely, this is my general accent for everything. It's Arabic accent, right? If you listen closely, you may hear the voice of God. I went, alright, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to listen closely. I'm going to close my eyes. And he was doing this. He was playing the piece, whatever. And then I could hear him, and he's talking to the sound engineer, and the mic's going, more tabla, more tabla, more tabla. That's not the voice of God. He broke my concentration. I'm going to listen, and he's going, more tabla. Yeah, right, good on you, buddy. Yeah, nice one. He's going to watch it. I'm trying to train the audiences that come and see my shows to just put on your narrative senses. Because sometimes wood players, they know how to do it. And I've got friends who are wood players, professional wood players, they know how to do it. You know, I know this guy talks about Saddam putting him in jail. Always, every concert he's got to talk about Saddam putting him in jail. I mean, that was like 30 years ago. Like, let it go, buddy. You know, let it go. Saddam got hanged 10 years ago. I mean, like, write a piece about that. Saddam's gone, but he's still pushing that thing. Like, stop it. You know, gets up on stage, he does this thing. If you want a longer clap, you just got to keep your bowing longer. So what he does, he gets up, and he knows how to work the audience, he gets on stage, and it's like everyone's clapping, and he's just got his head down, and everyone's, yeah! And then the more you have your head down, the more people clap, and then they yell out. It's ridiculous. It's not on that type of behaviour. Let's play some music, hey? Enough narrative. People love that stuff. They get on the wood and they go, yes, this next piece I'm going to play because my wife left me and it was really hot in the summer and I didn't talk. And thank you for having me in Australia because music unites people and we should unite everybody because we love everybody and music is unity. And yeah, good on you, mate. All right, hurry up. Let's go. Let's play some music. Music unites. Let me tell you something. The biggest thing, I hate it when people go, music's a universal language. It's not a universal language. It's not. I mean, you've got some vocabulary that maybe crosses over, but I don't go and pump Chinese music at home. I've got nothing against Chinese music, but I'm just not going home and pumping, Chinese pop or anything. It's not music, universal language. What's going on there? Have you ever seen a Chinese opera? Go see a Chinese opera and then tell me if that's a universal language. But man, that is intense. Like, there's so much stuff going on. I've got no idea what's going on, but I can appreciate it. Got some vocabulary. I think maybe one of the notes they hit, I've played once upon a time. One of the notes maybe crossed over somehow. I don't know. Maybe the pans that they were hitting, James, maybe you did a similar rhythm at some point. But I'm not going to go. Just saying. Narrative sensor. Just put it on. The Arabs are good at it. Remember, when you go to wood school, they teach you 80% narrative, 20% technique. That's the formula.
Where did you
go? Well, we never went to wood school. I went to the University of New South Wales. I was like the novelty act. I was struggling. All these classical musicians. And they say, what did you do? Yes, I went to classes since I was 4. You know what? This is a true story, John. You don't know this. But, I went to uni, right? And I was like the only ethnic music. There was no other no one doing any other ethnic stuff. It was just, the novelty act, Joe Tawadros here. Where is he? Performance practice. Everybody used to bring their instruments and play. And somebody would play something from Bach. And everyone would comment on it. And then I'd get up and they'd just go, yeah, I don't know, that's probably a part of the culture. Yeah, that's pretty cool. The other ones are going, oh yeah, you should add more vibrato. Oh yes, your bow, just extend your bow and I'd get up and I'll play. And everyone's like, yeah, fair call, that's about it. I think it was out of tune, but it was probably part of the culture. Keep going. Second class. Can't push it down. Can't get me first class, I don't know what's going on. Scrutinize, this could be a problem. We're going to move on. It's the end of the concert.
Yeah.
So I read this book, How to Lose an Audience at the End of a Concert. Great book. Just nearly finished it. That's doing pretty well. Anyway, thank you very much for coming. There's CDs for sale at the back. if you like, including the new one. I know CD players are scarce at the moment. There's not many CD players. You buy a computer now, no CD player. They're really trying, you know, everything's on Spotify and all that sort of mumbo jumbo. Don't do that. Buy a CD. Take one home. Yeah. It's got covers, there's pictures on the inside, there's even a poem. Don't get that.
You know, you can touch it. You can touch it.
I hope you're talking about the CD.
Yeah.
Just random people yelling things out at me. You can touch it. What the hell does that mean? Disgusting. What a disgusting audience. I've never had anyone yell out at me, "You can touch it." I don't know what that means.
Talking about the CD.
CDs, anyway, CDs are available up the back. You know, I always say use them as coasters on the table. You know, it's always nice because, you know, if you take them home, especially if you're Australian, you know, and you've got, you know, white friends. You can, you know, they go, "Oh, what's this on the coffee table, eh? Oh, it's a bit of this ethnic music, eh? Hey, Maureen, I didn't know you liked this. Tell you what." And then Maureen will say, "They come here and take our jobs, but they come here and take our jobs, but they play a mean old, don't they?" I promise you, no one has ever said that in Australia. No one's ever gone, "They've taken our jobs, but they play a mean old." Most of this stuff's just joking. Just trying to make you guys happy so you can then appreciate the music. So you go, "Yeah, he's finally shut up, play some music." So that's trying to do it. It's a contrast. Anyway, let's play some more music. The last piece we're going to play for you. Once again, thank you very much for coming. It's great to have a full room. If you guys want to come back here, all the same terrible jokes. We're playing on the 26th of June for a flyout. Jam's going to be pumped. He's going to bring all sorts of percussion things. Cajon will be here. Frame drums. Wreck.
James.
On fire. His fan club's clapping. James is very popular. You should see him at the festival. He's really popular. You know, James, he was getting signatures before I ever was.
We love James.
I know. Everyone loves James. I love him too. That's why I'm on the stage. I don't put people I hate on the stage. I love James. You should see our pep talks before the concerts. We're talking serious things. We go, "Come on, guys, I need a nice clean game." You know, all that sort of stuff. Some car, keep it low. Keep it in the low register. Dimitri, keep it long. You know, we've got all our roles. Matt, smash it. You know, Matt McMahon, what a legend. Matt McMahon. It's like that, I don't know if you guys know rugby league, but Tommy Radonikis, remember he used to slap it in their faces before the game? That's what we do. Anyway, so let's play some music. This piece is called Bluegrass Decree. So James and I recorded with the great Bella Fleck, banjo player, in 2013, and I started experimenting with some banjo lines, and I came up with this piece called Bluegrass Decree, which combines two scales, the Decree scale, Arabic mode, and the blues scale. Yeah. The thing is, you don't know about the blues scale, a very physical scale. See, the lower you go, the scrunchier the face gets. So it's very physical. The shoulder goes up, got back problems, got to lean back. All of the blues players are like... It's a very physical game. You gotta know that. You gotta keep in tip top shape. You did 6 hours of yoga this morning just for that scale. Anyway, let's play. It's going to start with a percussion solo on Rec, and we're going to play Bluegrass Chris. Once again, thank you very much for coming, and hopefully we'll see you all again.